That's the question asked by so many of us who love Queen's iconic song, Bohemian Rhapsody. I'm Fred Karpoff, and today we're going to spend some time appreciating this rock masterpiece from the perspective of a pianist. I'll refer to what I call whole-body, three-dimensional technique of how to play the piano. And also, I'll contrast classical and rock musical approaches. It's not so surprising that record producers were flummoxed as to what to do with this song. It didn't fit their paradigm of what was normal for a pop song. 6 minutes long, and it's in five parts. There's an introduction, a rock ballad that actually has two verses, ending with Brian May's guitar solo, and that brings us into this rather bizarre, fantastical opera section. That leads into a rock shuffle, and then finally there's a shorter outro or brief reflective coda. The introduction is a cappella, with Freddie singing all of the voices overdubbed. The piano enters at "Open Your Eyes" on this G minor arpeggio. So an arpeggio is a figure like this on a chord that's broken, in this case, ascending and descending. And what we often find is that arpeggios are played poorly like this, with the hand fixed in position, out of alignment like this. But if you play with your whole body, you can stay in alignment here and just follow the natural sort of elliptical or circular sort of flow this way. In this case, notice that I've released my thumb already. Here I've released this finger. So the hand's always staying small. So this is a three-dimensional approach to playing this arpeggio. And really, I think anyone can play this kind of figure. In the next measure, we have this B-flat 7 chord. And notice how all the choral voices, still all Freddie, are syncopated at "Look up to the skies and see." So it goes like this. Look up to the skies and see. So if you play that E-flat chord before you sing the word see, you're too early. If you clap it, it's look up to the skies and see. That is syncopated on every single beat going into that.
Open your eyes, look up to the skies and see.
The next measure lets the music breathe before "I'm just a poor boy." More important to me is that it has this figure, the A flat to E flat. It's just a hint of what's going to become a very important motive that's going to also go to there. But this time it's just before heading into the a more driving rock beat. In rock music, you have accents on beats 2 and 4. And so Freddie is starting to animate the piano part to transition us over to the rock ballad coming very soon. If you play this section, the C minor, I would play that with a little more pop on these chords. And the syncopations continue as well. So you have the right hand is syncopated against the left hand being steady. If you have 1, 2, 3, 4, that brings us up to the chromatic slide chords. We have B major, B flat major, A major, B flat major. The next few measures, Freddie plays strong accents on beats 2 and 4 for the first time, like this. Now again, if I were playing this classical and they were just accents, I would probably play like this. So I still gave accents on some of those, but look at what I'm doing physically. I'm playing from the key. And this is a good way to play accents. You play from the key and thrust forward. But in this context for the song, I find myself rotating more. Well, what's rotation? We have to rotate our arms just to get them up to the piano because we have the two bones in our arm, the radius and the ulna. And once we rotate to here, we're now in a piano playing position with the bones crossed. So by actually rotating a little farther toward the thumb and then lifting my hand, I'm sort of throwing it back in a rotation to get a little more pop on the chord like this. That leads us to a big crescendo on the F7 chord where it goes to me. And then we finally arrive. When I first heard this, I thought for sure that Freddie was crossing over with an octave like this. So notice, this note is important. Both of these notes are important because if I don't play this bottom note, it feels really pale. But if you watch on videos, Freddie is playing this with his right hand. So the right hand plays this. So that needs to be practiced carefully, hands alone, if you're going to be able to play this well, I think. Because this is an arpeggio, and then this is sort of what we call a tremolo. We often feel that tremolos, or we think of them as like this, a really fast one. So this is a very slow tremolo movement that uses rotation. And if your hand is small, you're going to need to release. So after this, just like I said on the three-dimensional arpeggio, let your hand stay small, but many hands do not even reach this ninth interval. They might only reach this far. So you're going to have to release that and maybe trust the pedal to allow you to do this. You can just move your hand in this fashion. The left hand by itself is just this with the bass line and then reaching over like this. And when you put them together, you get... And then after he begins his verse with "Mama just killed a man," this continues and the harmony intensifies. But this figure always has the dissonance on the first note of the crossover. The first chord, we could call it a B-flat 6 chord, which we take as a jazz chord or pop chord. But if it's just B-flat, we still have the dissonance of G. And it resolves to the main note. In these cases, over here of G minor, and the next one, we have a ninth, or second above the tonic. Let's say, call it a ninth. So it goes 9/8. And then finally we get to C minor. And it kind of intensifies this kind of feeling of longing. At "now I've gone and thrown it all away," what we have here is a chromatic descent, that is by half steps. We hear this, and it's in all three of these voices. So we hear it in the left hand's part, of course, with the octaves, but it's also happening in the thumb of the right hand. And so this is another place where you can use rotation. You'll see that I'm shaping the arpeggio, kind of land onto this, and when you rotate in this direction, you rotate back to here. So it's basically moving like this. Many people think this is like turning a doorknob, and that's kind of right, but I would recommend that you think of it as being a little deeper, a little more back toward the elbow. And notice how I'm using my left arm to sort of rotate my arm over like this. That makes it much easier to play this figure. Just after that, there's a spot in the left hand that goes like this. At "if I'm not back again this time tomorrow." That brings us to the interlude between the first and second verse. And now we have the full presentation of that motive that we've had foreshadowed earlier, before the second verse starts there with the vamp. So here's the motive. It's A flat major, E flat major, F sharp diminished 7, F minor 7. But that analysis isn't so important. It's much more important to notice that descent, that contour from A flat. There's a major third, but then these are three minor thirds. And that will be developed further in really interesting ways coming forward. But this brings us first to the vamp. And after two measures that, we get "Too late, my time has come." And the music is similar in this verse until "sometimes I wish I'd never been born at all." And that hands off to Brian May's guitar solo. Brian said that he wanted to take a verse and continue the narrative, to continue the story of the narrator. And so this is a famous solo. And if you want to play this at the piano, there are some rather advanced elements here. if we just isolate it fairly slowly the first time, because this is a figure that ends up sounding and feeling like a trill at various times, like this, at speed, it's... So in slow motion, you have... That's a lot of stuff happening. So eventually it's going to feel more improvisational, but notice that to play that, I can't have my fingers be tense. I can't have fingers up in the air. Just have to be really loose. Now, a much harder option is to play some sort of consolidation of Freddie's piano playing and Brian's guitar solo. At the end of the section, the band plays pretty loudly, and Freddie animates his part with octaves and arpeggios like this. And that's the transition to the opera section. I see a little silhouette of a man. Now, have we heard this music anywhere before? Think about it. Now, if I change this to this, could go there, and it's exactly the same music. It's that motive again that we had up here where it was in E flat major. But in this case, comes back here. So we get, and in this voice, it's. So this is really cool. It's motivic development. And that's a technique that composers through history have used, including especially composers like Mozart and Beethoven and composers after that as well. And it really helps to unify a piece. Even if we're not so consciously aware of it, we get a lot of subconscious pleasure out of this. And now when we analyze it, we can see that Freddie's creatively applied this in many places. So here we have the I see a little silhouette. And another thing this spot is great for is to show how Queen is known for its fantastic rhythm. When you have really fine musicians who can play an ensemble that's together with one another with really great rhythm by collaborating as opposed to being bound to a metronome or to a beat, really magical things can happen. But something that my teacher, Leon Fleischer, often said was that the secret of rhythmic playing is to play as late as possible while still playing in time. Well, what does that mean? If you have something like this where you play your rhythms really dull and it was a machine that didn't have any other instructions other than said, these are eighth notes and 16th notes, it would be something like this. Right? But that has no inflection. It's no human quality in it at all. So instead of that, if you did I see a li, so C and a becomes to an upbeat of sorts to li of little. So I see a little silhouette of a man. And especially in a word like scaramouche, so that name. If you did scaramouche, scaramouche, it would be really dull rhythm. But if you think of scara being the upbeat to mouche, then you get scaramouche, scaramouche, will you do the fandango? And Freddie and the band are really, really good at this kind of rhythm. They also do this at a place like Thunderbolt and Lightning. So after you've had this spot, will you do the fandango, Thunderbolt and Lightning? That when Thunderbolt comes in, it's arresting partly because it's loud and it's a full chorus, but it's also that they're as late as possible while still being in time. So that kind of sense of rhythm really is something special about this performance. Scaramouche, scaramouche, will you do the fandango? Thunderbolts and lightning, very, very frightening me. Then we get a kind of bizarre, previously unheard of effect with the Galileo exchange. So that sounds very strange, and right after that it's interrupted by Magnifico, Magnifico. So let's look at what's happening here. We have And that means if one voice comes in and holds it, that's either a C minor 7 chord, or you could call it an E flat add 6, an E flat 6 chord. Either one, it's the same chord. And that cascade kind of adds this eerie effect by, first you've had this, and that's interrupted, so it's very sparse, and then you have this thick sounding overdubbed sound of a big chorus going magnifico, and then in turn it goes to the sparseness of I'm just a poor boy. Where did we hear this music before? Well, now Freddie has doubled the time. Remember, at the very beginning of the piece, in the introduction, he had easy come, easy go. Now it's I'm just a poor boy. So it's those chromatic sliding chords again. B major, B flat major, A major, and B flat major. And then the choir bursts in with he's just a poor boy from a poor family. And have we heard this music before? Of course we have. It's the motive one more time. It's the same motive of, but he's animated it in a new way and made it fortissimo with a full chorus and really charged it rhythmically with that secret of rhythmic playing. He's just a poor boy. It doesn't go, he's just a poor boy. It's really exciting. And then you get to spare him his life of this monstrosity. And after that, listen to this. Wow, there's the motive again as 16th notes. So it's twice as fast as what it was before. Remember, the original was. And for this quick interlude after monstrosity, monstrosity, easy come, easy go. It's just genius. Galileo, Galileo, Galileo Figaro.
Magnifico. I'm just a poor boy and nobody loves me.
He's just a poor boy from a poor family, sparing his life from this one.
After Freddie returns to the chromatic slide on easy come, easy go, will you let me go? The choir bursts in with the devil's chorus of Bismillah, no, we will not let you go, let him go. So it's called sort of antiphonal singing or call and response singing, where you have the low voices going Bismillah, no, and we will not let you go. And at the top we get let him go. And on the top voice, Roger Taylor has that wonderful high voice. And if you listen, his voice hangs on longer to the top note. He goes, let me go. But the rest of it goes, let me go. And they come off of it right away. So that exchange happens for quite some time until it gets shorter and shorter and then goes into another one of those vocal cascades on the last, never let me go. And you get, no, 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 no.
Mamma mia.
And then the grand ending of this section, which transitions us into what's going to be the rock shuffle, where you have Beelzebub has a devil put aside for me. And we reach this B flat 7 chord, and that is what prolongs the preparation for the rock shuffle. So what does Freddie do? He creates a long crescendo for me, and then the animated rhythm becomes triplets. You hear it in Roger's drums, and then you hear it in Freddie's playing too. For me, boom. This is not really a solo piano featured spot, but I would advise using the left hand as steady quarter notes, or in this case, they're actually dotted quarter notes. This is really in 12/8, which is a compound meter. You don't count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. You count 1, 2, 3, 4, because 12/8 is really 4 beats in a bar, but it just shows that there are 3 subdivisions in each beat. So, ya da 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 da. So we get da 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 da. That's the solo of the guitar. And if you just have steady beats in the left hand, this goes for 4 measures until Freddie comes in with the really angry singing on So You Think You Can. The last words Freddie sings in this section are just gotta get out, just gotta get right out of here. And those have a kind of driving rhythm. They're triplets against duplets, kind of. Just gotta get out, just gotta get right out of here. And that brings Brian May's main guitar solo of this section back in. After that, there's a cadenza. There are three measures of guitar solos, and in the studio version, you have one measure that goes like this after the, here it is. That's in one channel. If you're listening with stereo headphones, you'll hear that on one side. I think it's the left side. And then on the right side, you get this. And then back in the left, you get, before Freddie comes in with the piano octaves. So when Brian had to do that live, obviously he couldn't prepare it and just have the overlaps that were going in with the overdubs. So he had to learn that and perform it all at once, something like this. Outro, or this reflective coda, the band is still playing pretty full for a few measures at the, and they do the oh yeah, oh yeah, and I always think this is a kind of magic spot to get to the spot where Freddie sings "Nothing Really Matters." And so it kind of melts into this section. And pretty soon we're back to this early rock ballad feel. And with he's taken away all those hard accents that we saw coming about in the first section. So it's "Nothing Really Matters." But here he does pop the fourth beat. Before in the first section, note that I was talking about how he often gave a little kick to the second beat. But here he says, "Nothing really matters. Bop. Anyone can see." Boom. Gives another accent there. So when he's breathing or when there's no word, he often gives a little accent there. And then it's a "nothing really matters." And that's, there actually is a hold there. In classical music, we call that a fermata. And after that, it's in time for the next measure. It goes, "Nothing really matters to me." But what's different about this that couldn't be accomplished with a click track, and that means most of the music from today again, is that he uses rubato. That means there's a flexible beat. It's still moving forward with some logic, but it's more about what is he feeling? What's special about this? And some of these notes are kind of dissonant. And then this. Brian comes up with something like dee-da-dee-da, you-da-dee-da. And what do we get at the end? "Any way the wind blows." And where do we hear this before again? He ends with the motive. In this case, it's up a step in F major. It's really pretty remarkable. Thanks for joining me on this journey. I look forward to seeing what you think in the comments. If you enjoyed this video, please like and subscribe, and tell your family and friends that there are some classical pianists talking about chromaticism in Bohemian Rhapsody.